Good evening. I'm happy to welcome you to this evening session number two in our education series. I think it's called the speaker series. We're here to learn before we brainstorm on the Kilimani we want. Last week we had an excellent session, and I'm sure this week we shall continue with a similar pattern. It's my pleasure to invite Rose, whom we all know as an eminent planner, urban planner, to continue to educate us on this series.
As I said last time, the brief I had from your group or your residents is to sort of like build capacity on plans that are likely to affect Kilimani. And last time I was blessed to have my colleagues, very senior colleagues of mine, who after I presented really clarified a lot of things. We had a lot of questions, and I think it went on well. Now, the second series, actually this is the core of our discussion, because last time we talked about planning and master plan, the Nairobi master plan, where we went through and we looked at the proposals in that big strategic plan, how it affects this area. Now today I was supposed to talk about the plans that Nairobi County is likely to prepare for various regions in this city. As I said last time, a master plan is a broad vision plan, which is too broad to be implemented at the local level. So the city will still have to parcel or to zone the city and prepare local detailed plans for each and every zone so that they can implement the master plan and realize the vision of the master plan. So the master plan, you should not expect it to really influence development in Kilimani, because it's dealing with strategic, it's showing where the big infrastructure will go, where the big cities developments will go, but it's not coming to the local neighborhood. So this is the plan that will really impact on Kilimani, and is a plan you can use to mobilize resources, and is a plan that you can actually implore upon the county to implement so that you can realize some quality of life in the area. So I decided to bring this model so that, because last time there were questions that were being asked, how do we get the county to implement this? How does this integrate, get into the financing of the county government? And how does this get into the government financing programs? If you look at this, I did not go down below here. This is the urban development side of everything. This is the financing side of this plan. This new plan is Nairobi Integrated Urban Development Master Plan. A lot of you are concerned about pollution. This is where the programs are. Then it has now the local area plans. These are the instruments that will realize implementation of this. You use this to implement this. So how do these then get implemented by the national government and by the county? It is through this flowchart. The county will finance it through its own appropriation. The county will source externally mobilized resources like donors, etc. And also they can do it through PPP. So anything they want to implement here, they have to go through this process. How do you unpack this to be implementable? It's through what they are calling strategic plan, a corporate plan, which is already actually done. It was very, very well done. And out of this strategic plan gets the vision of this master plan, the flagship projects, the programs, and the details, the program, the projects that you are going to get in this when you prepare the plan, and puts them here for 25 years. Now, when they put it for 25 years, it's implemented through what we call CIDP. A lot of you were asking, what is CIDP? It's County Integrated Development Plan. This is a financial one, which is going to be, it's an instrument to access funding. So this one is prepared from the strategic plan to make sure if there is a road that is proposed, it's budgeted for. And how do then the county implement it? Through what they call annual plans. When I was in Nairobi County, we were making reference to this and this to prepare annual plans. So within the 25 years, they assume through annual plans, they will implement the programs. There's what they call performance management plan. These annual plans are implemented through by various departments of the county through performance contracts. They make sure you deliver. They are deliverables expected. So you can see if you prepare a good plan that is really capturing the needs of the people and addressing all sectors of environmental, infrastructure, etc., it will find its way in implementation by Nairobi County. At the same time, the city is not only for Nairobi. It is national. It's a capital city. So it falls into the sectoral plans. And when I talk about sectoral plan, it's the agencies, Kura, Kena, everybody, housing, department, etc. They normally prepare what they call sectoral investment plans. So for anything for Nairobi, they love to collect it here. If they want to do a road, let's say it's a ring road, they have to collect it here, prepare it as an investment in their investment plans, and then get funding from the government. Let's say there's a major road. It has to go here because it is a government, it's a national government program. If it's a program that is city-based, it will come to this side. So I think that this model is very important. I decided to do it because last time people did not, they said this is plans we are proposing, how do you implement them? This is my own definition of what a local area plan is. I did not get it from anywhere. It's not defined yet because people are still grappling, what is this small plan? But it's basically a specific detailed plan that implements the master plan at a local level where you come into neighborhood and you start saying, what is the vision for the city of Nairobi? And that vision, you get it from this new plan, and then you translate it to the people down. It is also, this plan is an implementation mechanism of county policies and national. This plan is also going to draw from Vision 2030. The new plan looks, contextualizes what is being proposed in the Vision 2030 for the Nairobi city. And then the city itself, the plan, this small little plan, then has to collect information from there so that it makes sense, so that it's in tandem with government programs. So also it guides an area, how an area will grow, will change over a period of time while protecting its best qualities. So it's a plan that is going to be very careful. When you are preparing it, you have to be very careful because it has resources and you want to fully utilize these resources. So it's basically that. The process of preparing that plan involves identification of potentials in the area. As I talked last time about what I think about Kilimani, what are the potentials and the factors that inhibit full utilization of that particular potential. And then you develop strategies of stimulating these potentials. How do you use them? So it's a really a compact, a stimulating plan, a plan that you really can pick bankable projects from it. It provides for development requirements of Kilimani to make optimal use of existing resources to offer good quality of life for the people. So if you follow the principles as discussed about a local plan, progressively as we implement them, the quality, it's assumed that the quality of life will change for the area here. What is the legal basis of this plan? The Constitution recognizes urban planning as a key in promoting sustainable development. And this Constitution is a third recognition is found in Article 184, which makes urban areas planning mandatory through an integrated plan. It's actually without this plan, you can't access the government donation that they go to counties. This article requires that planning is done at lowest level practical. And this is where we fall. This article says that you have to do planning up to the lowest level practical, so that you capture the needs and the aspiration of the people. And there, and also it links, it expects, this article expects planning to be linked with budget, so that you can plans make economic sense. So that's why I introduced the model in the beginning there. Therefore, this recognition provides an opportunity for a consultative framework in planning urban management, because if it's recognizing that it has to go to the lowest level, then it has to promote dialogue. It has to promote discussions around it. And therefore, these are the tenets that are recognized by that article. Then the legal framework is further strengthened by Urban Areas and Cities Act, that every city shall operate within a framework of integrated plan, and that the plan shall be basis of preparation of the lower level plans. These are, in other words, without reading all this, in other words, you are within the law too. The plan is within the law, it is recognized, it is supposed to be people driven and people centered. This is the process of preparing that plan. It might not really be, this is not cast on stone. You have to get the information, you have to discuss with the public, you have to develop a vision, do the draft local area plan, publish it for people to see, and at the end of the day is it comes to finalization of the plan. So the process is quite elaborate. I've just summarized, actually, basically. Consultation and consensus is a requirement, as I said also in this article, Schedule 2 of Urban Areas and Cities. Consultation and consensus building is very important. So public participation and consensus with many different interested groups, local communities, state agencies, business community, all these people have to be talked to throughout the plan preparation, so that the plan is actually representation of what people are looking for in their neighborhood. Through consultations, a lot of information is collected from the people. A lot of people in Kilimani or anywhere else, they have a lot of information of the area because they know it better. They even know how it functions, they know the resources within it, they know the problems. So you collect a lot of information through consultations. So when you also participate in consultations and consensus building on the plan, you also appreciate better the implementation. There's ownership, there's capacity building. You build capacity on the citizens to understand what is this. This is our planning. And this is where I think we are beaten by developed countries. They really own their plan. You cannot even change anything. They own it. And it's because they have participated, their capacity has been raised, and they are quite happy with the plan. So it's not something imposed. The structure and the content. The content is actually, this is Urban Areas and Cities Act. It actually gives the content. It's along the steps to be followed in preparing this. In my opinion, in an existing developed area like this place, a local plan should take account of the following. You should reinforce existing neighborhood facilities. You should reinvigorate them. You know, we should look at how do we enhance them? How do we improve them? You know, the social facilities, the community and recreational facilities, we should be talking about, because the area is already built, how do we reinvigorate, how do we energize those areas? Those, among other contents, these should not be left out. Then, how do we improve the public domain? How do we provide active frontages to all public spaces, routes, promoting streets which are encourage pedestrian activity? How do we make the place active and livable, so that we can make the place safe? You know, some of these, in addition to the contents, some of these needs to be considered when you are preparing the plan. We need to promote mixed use here to ensure the area is both living and working with adequate local employment opportunities. We discussed about my colleagues who are very passionate about mixed use development that is compact, that is encouraging, that brings economies of scale in terms of sharing facilities, sharing infrastructure. So we should really look into how do we make the place a livable place for working and employment. We should also encourage residents to adopt smart ways of traveling within their community. So either cycling or walking. So it means that we have to look at the streets. These are the small details that you will not find in the act being given. But these are very important. I've collected this in a lot of experiences I've had with cities, other cities. We should also be talking about promoting sustainable and safe communities by identifying areas of risk of flooding so that we avoid to build. How do we protect these fragile ecologies or areas in Kilimani? These are areas you cannot ignore when you are preparing the plan. Other area is conserving and enhancing local heritage. We keep on losing a lot of heritage in this country. Nobody's bothered, but this defines identity and sense of place for local communities. There must be some things we would like to conserve here, to talk about this is our Kilimani. There must be a Mabati house somewhere or some things we want to conserve. So these are very key tenets that you should not leave out. Then we have to deliver high quality urban design. We have to think about doing urban design that is quality for the area. As we plan, as we propose, we need to think about urban design because it's key on creating this and flourishing economic life and for social progress. A city is defined by its urban design. Like if you get to Chicago, you'll see how the urban design is. You see the public spaces. The character is defined, you know. You have an identity of some sort. So good urban design helps in creating lively places with distinctive character, streets and public spaces that are safe, accessible and pleasant to use. So those are a few of the things that I've added as we make the plan. The first key thing is to identify where you are going to get funding. How are you going to get funding to implement that place, plan, because it has projects that really are going to change this area. So you identify the funding. I believe you'll be doing it in Nairobi County, so you'll come up with a strategy of funding, mechanisms for how do you deliver and how do you fund, and then mechanisms for provision of the, particularly the physical and social. When I talk physical, I'm talking about sewer, water, etc., etc. And in most cases, implementation is good when it's done in phases. So in my opinion, this, of course, we can develop this. I was just coming here to just highlight what that plan, what you expect the city to talk to you about. And it's basically, that's purely the structure. You won't see any different structure from what you have said, but I've added what I think will make the plan reach. And with that, I thank you.